It's rivalry week in the Empire State, where a snowstorm yesterday has transformed Albany into a winter wonderland. Today, the locals look to warm themselves in the bask of the battle for the Golden Apple as the Albany Great Danes host the Stony Brook Seawolves. Taking a look at the CAA standing, Stony Brook still has a shot to share the conference crown. They need a win and a main loss, and we'll keep you updated on the CAA scores all afternoon long. Hi, everybody. I'm Matt Jamitz alongside former Philadelphia Eagle and Memphis Tiger Ken Dunnick, and this is the CAA on Fox College Sports. Ken, not only is this a rivalry game today, but Stony Brook still has an awful lot on the line.
Matt, Stony Brook could lock up a home playoff game this afternoon. That'll be up to the committee. But don't sell the Great Danes short. They've lost three games at the buzzer this year, and they could be a tough out this afternoon.
Indeed they can, and if you like good running attacks, this is the game to watch. We have four of the most talented backs in the CAA. Let's start with Stony Brook's dynamic duo.
Yes, the tandem of two senior running backs, Donald Leotine on the left and Jordan Gowans on the right. They're each averaging around 6 yards per carry this year. They are a big part of this offensive attack. Leotine more of a speed guy, Gowans more of a power guy, both excellent running backs.
Meanwhile, for Albany, the duo of Elijah Ebi Token Hanks and Carl Mofor, no slouches themselves.
Absolutely, two very good running backs that Albany presents here this afternoon. Ebi Token Hanks coming off an injury in 2017, and Carl Mofor actually filled in for him last year, doing a very good job. Both excellent running backs in their own right, and a big part of this Albany offense.
So this is the battle for the Golden Apple. A lot of history in this series as they play for a trophy, a rivalry game in the CAA. And as we look back at the last couple of seasons, how this game has unfolded, it's only controlled by defense. 2 years ago, the Great Danes got a defensive touchdown, and that's what set them up to celebrate as they won a hard-fought game by 7 points. And Greg Catuzzo's team got to hoist that big trophy. Last year, Stony Brook found a way to get revenge as a game that was nip and tuck throughout. Big touchdown pass in overtime, lifting the Seawolves to a victory, and they got the trophy back on Long Island. This is the 20th all-time meeting between these two schools. As we mentioned, Stony Brook won the last matchup, but Albany in control overall, 11-8. Both of these teams were in the Northeast Conference until 2007. Stony Brook left the league, but both programs joined the CAA a half decade ago. We mentioned the snow yesterday. Well, much warmer today, fortunately, 44 degrees. Winds could be a factor, about 12 miles per hour. Steady, gusting a little bit higher than that. Mostly cloudy, although that's not a big deal because we only have about 45 minutes to an hour left of sunlight. Anyways, you see that pretty shot out of the distance beyond Bob Ford Field here. Chuck Priori is the head coach at Stony Brook. Ushered the program from the Northeast Conference to the Big South. Now the CAA, during his 13 years in charge with the Seawolves. When Priori arrived on Long Island, Stony Brook doled out only 20 scholarships. They're now a fully funded FCS program, 63 scholarships they give out, and that's one of the reasons why they're a top 10 team in the country. Meanwhile, Greg Catuzzo is in his fifth year as Albany's head coach. He took over for the legendary Bob Ford, who literally built the program from scratch. It went from the club level to the best FCS conference in the country. Catuzzo won a national championship as a player at Penn State in the 80s and had good, successful stints as an assistant at Pitt. Let's update you on the CAA standings. We showed you where they were a little earlier coming into the day, a couple of finals and some surprises. First of all, congratulations to Maine as they have clinched a CAA championship with their 27-26 victory over Elon. Meanwhile, Delaware gets shocked at home by Villanova, 42-21. And as a result, Delaware drops to 7-4. Maine clinches the conference crown. And also one other final, Rhode Island was able to beat New Hampshire. So congratulations to the Rams, a 500 finish in conference play and a winning season overall at 6-5. Stony Brook will get the football as they won the toss. Ethan Stark will kick it away. Donald Leotine back to return for the Seawolves. And this is a big one. Rivalry game, but more importantly, a win for Stony Brook. And there's no worry. Tomorrow during the selection show, they will be in the FCS playoffs no matter what. Albany trying to salvage its season by pulling the upset as we are underway. Leotine from the two. And Leotine's got some space as he turns it up. A flag is down, bounces off a couple of defenders, and Leotine is gone. Donald Leotine with one to beat all the way to the 5-yard line. But multiple markers down, and it might all be for naught.
Well, it probably is for naught. We'll get the call here.
During the return, illegal blow in the back. Return team, number 40. 10 yards, first down.
Regardless of the call, what an effort by Donald Leotine taking that kickoff back. Absolutely crushes a would-be tackler. You can see he gets a good head of steam. Running downhill, turns it upfield, and then punishes a couple of tacklers, stays on his feet. Able to maintain his balance, take it all the way down deep into Albany territory. But unfortunately for Stony Brook, it's going to come all the way back.
Boy, it didn't matter, but great hustle by Kareem Gibson to go chase him down. I thought Leotine would walk into the end zone once he broke free. Randy Pringle is the guilty party, so a big change in field position from inside the Albany 10 to inside their own 10. Joe Carbone runs the offense for the Seawolves. As a senior quarterback, first and 10, as Gowans in the backfield, he gets the handoff straight ahead and barrels his way out to the 13-yard line, a gain of almost 5 yards on first down.
You will see a lot of the rushing game by Stony Brook this afternoon. Old school football, they like to ground and pound, play good defense, rush the football. Kind of stuff I was used to back in the day.
You look at the rest of the starting lineup, very strong up front. They go seven deep, rotate a couple of bodies to keep everybody fresh, but as physical a line as you'll find in the CAA. Tyrone Wheatley goes in motion. Gowans again on second down, hit at the line of scrimmage, and maybe gets a yard. Nice effort by Great Danes defensive lineman Nick Dillon on senior day, making the stop. It'll be third down.
Well, third and four, you would think it's obvious passing situation, but Stony Brook likes to run the ball in these situations. They've got great confidence in their offensive line and these two running backs. We'll see what they decide here.
They need the 18-yard line to keep the offense on the field. Already had to deal with the penalty that cost them a golden opportunity. Carbone to Wheatley, can't make the catch. A.J. Missler with a big hit, jostling the ball free, and the Great Danes force a three and out.
Well, A.J. Missler on the defense. Watch this. Now, he's trying to tackle a guy that's 295 pounds, and Wheatley is able to break up that pass. Excellent effort by A.J. Missler.
So what a turn of events on the penalty. Instead of the short field, a three and out, and Albany should get good field position. Donovan McDonald back to return for the Great Danes as Mark Nolan gets away. Good kick. McDonald from midfield makes the first miss and inside the 45 to the 43. So a 35-yard punt, 7-yard return, and now Albany's team back to work. You know, the Great Danes are 2-8 on the year. They're winless in conference play, but Greg Cattuso thinks they're a better team than that.
There's no question they're a better team than that. They've lost four games by less than a touchdown, three in the last minute. And when you look at the fickle nature of football, had they won those four games, they would be in the playoff conversation.
Second straight year that they have lost four games by a touchdown or less. Jack Undercutler making his third start at quarterback. On first down, Mo for straight ahead, tries to push the pile. And on second effort, works his way to the 42 for a gain of two. Undercutler made his debut against Maine and started the last couple of games. Looks pretty good for a young kid.
He is 6'5", a rangy freshman, down from my neck of the woods. Went to high school, Holy Cross High School, down in Burlington County, New Jersey. They're very pleased with what he has shown them the last couple games, and by far these are the best weather conditions he's had to play in this year.
They have played the last 2 weeks in a steady wind, has wreaked havoc on the passing game. Second down at 8. Mofor again breaks a tackle and fights his way inside the 35. He's about a half yard shy of the first down, but a good physical run from Carl Mofor.
Well, if they're going to win this game, they've got to block it up up front. And look at the job by this offensive line, clearing it out. Excellent block there by number 32, Greg Steyer, who's a former basketball player. Throws a nice block to spring that play.
Sincere Malone eventually making the stop. And third short, that's where Albany wants to live. Greg Cattuso talked about the importance this week of staying ahead of the sticks. Third down and less than a yard. Mofor again runs through the tackle and has the first down at the 33. Low man wins, and it was Mofor that time.
Excellent start to this football game for Albany. The unfortunate penalty for Stony Brook as they called back that great kickoff return. Now the offense for Albany has it deep in Stony Brook territory.
That was Albany's best against Stony Brook's best. Shane Lawless came up to fill the hole, and Mofor was able to push him ahead just enough to get the first down. So now Albany uses both of its backs in at the same time. Both E.B. Tokenhanks and Mofor out there. Mofor in motion. E.B. Tokenhanks on the draw, breaks a tackle, and works his way to the 30, a three-yard gain. It'll be second down and 7. The rest of the Albany starters, an offensive line that's gotten better each and every week for the Great Danes.
Very good offensive line. Jack Dudzinski, whose father is a coach here on the Albany staff, coached with Greg Cattuso at Maryland.
So after a three-yard pickup, second down and 7, there was some question whether Jerry Reeves would be able to go to wide receiver, but he's going to try to fight through some soreness. Repetti goes in motion. Play action. Undercutler under pressure, somehow escapes, checks it down. E.B. Tokenhanks to the 25. Good poise by the youngster.
Sure was. Watch the job he does of escaping this pass rush. Number 37, John Haggard for Stony Brook with the pressure. Does a little Carson Wentz duck down, strong enough to get out of the grasp and find the open receiver.
Have to like his poise that he found that open receiver with the pressure in his face right away. That's a young guy understanding the offense. So another third and short this time. Third down and 2. Again, Mofor and E.B. Tokenhanks both out there. This time it's E.B. Tokenhanks, and he's not going to get there. John Haggard chased the play down from behind. They lose a half yard, and it's fourth down. Looks like Albany will try a field goal.
Nice retribution there for Haggard, who wasn't able to come up with the sack, but brings down E.B. Tokenhanks well short of the first down marker.
Senior out of Sayville, New York. Trying to make sure this is not his final game today. Ethan Stark has had an excellent season as he will try it from 43. Got the distance, and Albany has the lead. So the Great Danes force a three and out, use the short field to set up a field goal, and they lead their rivals by 3 early. The snow yesterday, not ideal conditions up here in New York, so kind of a split fan draw so far today. A lot of Stony Brook fans, the home faithful happy as Albany got a stop and got a score as they get a 43-yard field goal from Ethan Stark. And the Great Danes on the board first, on top 3-0. Leontine had the big kick return last time, brought back by penalty. So this time they go with the sky kick to keep it away from them. But it's still going to be good field position for the Seawolves. Elijah Duff brings that one all the way across the 40 to the 42. So trying to kick it away from Leontine. Doesn't work out so well.
Well, Maryland tried that a couple times early this afternoon against Ohio State, and it worked. The first time was a little bit of a pooch kick, and they were able to recover it. Not sure if that was the intent there or they were trying to keep it away from Leontine.
So Carbone and company back to work. Leontine in the backfield on first down for the 42. He gets a fake his direction. Carbone keeps it as a big gainer. Joe Carbone inside the 10. And just like that, here come the Seawolves. They'll say he stepped out actually at the 17. Still a gain of 41 yards.
When you talk about the element of surprise, Joe Carbone comes into this game averaging 0.3 yards per rush. He's able to fake the handoff and take it down the sidelines for a big gain.
An immediate response. First down from the 17. Albany sold out trying to stop Leontine. He does get it this time and is pulled down after a short game. He's now just inside the 15-yard line. Levi Matheny on the stop for the Great Danes.
Excellent strength there by Levi Matheny.
On the stop for the Great
Leontine one-handed. He's a big, strong running back. That's hard to do.
So a second down and 7 after the 3-yard pickup. Carbone gives it to Leontine again. Big hit as he plasters his way to the 11. Three more yards. If you like old school football, this is the game for you. Going to be, even though we're on turf, a lot of 3 yards and a cloud of dust type of stuff.
Well, the pads are popping. We can hear it up here in the press box. Take a look good on good. Able to bring down Leontine there. Short of the first down.
So it sets up a 3rd down and 4 here for the Seawolves.
Wouldn't be surprised to see Stony Brook go 4 down territory here because they've had problems with their place kicker.
Carbone with some time, throwing for the end zone, almost intercepted. Kareem Brown, excellent coverage. And they were trying to get it to Julius Wingate, and Stony Brook will try for 3.
Yeah, I'm surprised. I really thought that they would try to rush the football there. Again, maybe part of the decision-making process is the element of surprise. Didn't work out.
You mentioned the problems at place kicker. This is their 3rd kicker of this season. Alex Lukanski, 3 of 5 on the year. Dead center of the field from 29. And he sneaks it inside the left upright to tie the game. So Chuck Priori's team pulls even. Joe Carbone on the nice fake. The long run gets him a field goal to tie the game. Each team with a field goal in the early going. You see Stony Brook, the 10th ranked team in the country. A lot of teams in the top 25. The Stats FCS National Poll in the CAA. Maine at 19. I think the most underrated team in the country. They clinched the conference crown earlier today.
No question. They clobbered New Hampshire the first game of the season. We were on that call. Everybody expected New Hampshire to beat Maine handily. They've had a great season. They win the conference outright. Really interesting to see what the committee does with the rest of these deserving CAA football teams.
No conference has ever gotten 6 teams into the FCS playoffs. And there are going to be 6 worthy candidates for the committee to consider tonight into early tomorrow. As they were late getting a football out there for the kickoff. After the made field goal, Courtney to boot it away for Stony Brook. Elon losing earlier, so they wrap up their season 6-4. Remember, they had a game canceled due to the hurricanes in North Carolina in September. And that might loom large. Interesting to see how the committee treats that. Green from inside the 5. Got a seam. Bouncing to the outside. And Juwan Green takes it in. To Stony Brook territory, an excellent return, and this time no flags down.
Nice work by Juwan Green. Watch, he finds the hole, he bounces it outside, creates an angle up the sideline, Trying to point out some blocking. Nice return.
Green transfer from Lackawanna Community College. Was not eligible until week three of the year. Been a steady threat at receiver with 20 catches on the season. And showing the athleticism on the return. So another short field for Albany. Second possession, second time starting in Stony Brook territory. Although they're going to go backwards five yards because they took too long.
Offense. 5 yards. Still first down.
That's going to frustrate Greg Cattuso and company.
Well, when you play a freshman quarterback, these types of things happen. He's got the play clock right in his face. He's got to pay attention.
That new rule has wreaked havoc on everybody this year. They're much quicker getting the play clock started, even on change of possession. And teams just have never grown accustomed to it. Play action to E.B. Token and Hanks. They find Green, who's out of bounds at the 40. He gets it right back near where he set the Great Danes up on the return, about a 5-yard pickup.
I like the poise by this young quarterback under Cuffler. Seen him play a couple times on film, and he seems to stand tall, not get rattled, and find the open target.
Replacing Vince Testaverde is under Cuffler. Testaverde injured in the main game, as was the backup, Will Brunson. He was third on the depth chart entering that contest against the Black Bears. On first down, it's E.B. Token Hanks. Nice jump cut. He spins his way near a first down. About a yard short, so it'll be third and about one. But a nice move from Elijah E.B. Token Hanks.
Yeah, nice to see him come back and have a productive, healthy season after missing most of 2017. Little bounce cut, finds a hole, and then look at the drive and determination to make the extra yards.
Been a long road back for E.B. Token Hanks. He injured the knee 2 years ago. Thought he would return last season. Played just one game before retweaking the injury. Electing to take a redshirt return this year. Greg Cattuso saying maybe not quite as explosive as he used to be, but he's awful effective still. Picks up a blitz here. Allows time, but a low throw off the hands of Deb Holmes, the freshman. And it'll be fourth down here for Albany.
First time they've targeted Dev Holmes, who's been the rookie player of the week 3 times in the conference. In fact, they want to go for it here on fourth down. Holmes seemed distracted. Not sure if he lost that ball in the lights. There's a little bit of glare here as the sun sets and they turn the lights on. Was not able to come up with that football.
That's a good call. You saw it on the replay there. Just never quite adjusted to the football. You see the offensive coordinator Joe Davis talking things over with Greg Cattuso, who will go for it on fourth and a long yard. Stony Brook blitzes, it's picked up, and this time Holmes sees it and holds on for a first down at the 30.
Well, let's give some credit to Joe Davis, the offensive coordinator for Albany. Confidence in this freshman quarterback, fourth and short, they decide to throw the ball. Dev Holmes with a nice catch. First down for the Great Danes.
Well, that'll make Joe Davis and company happy. Holmes, you mentioned 3-time CAA Rookie of the Week. What a debut he had in a game against Pittsburgh in the opener. Over 100 yards receiving. And it's just kind of gone from there. They fake it to E.B. Token Hanks. Under Cutler has some room to run. He tucks it inside the 25. Is near a first down. A yard short at the 21. Nice decision by the freshman.
Sure was. Once you make the decision, now you've got to turn on the jets. He shows me some speed there. He also shows me a little Drew Brees at the end of this play, stretching out the football to try to gain an extra yard or two as he goes out of bounds. Watch this at the end. Stretch it out. There you go. Good work.
Good job up front by the offensive line. Gave him a lot of time to survey his targets. Eventually, time ran out, and they created a pretty good seal for him to get to the outside. So second down and a yard. E.B. Token Hanks thought he had it. They brought it back, and then under Cutler threw it off an offensive lineman. And this is going to be pick your poison. Could be grounding. Could be an eligible receiver making contact. It'll be a decision for the official.
It's as we wait for the call. It will be interesting to see what the determination is.
Illegal touching. Offense, number 61. 5 yards from the previous spot. Still second one. Second down.
And Matt, that's a break, because if it were intentional grounding, he'd also lose the down. So better off that Albany gets the illegal touching call. See right here, gets a little shook with the rush, just finds the open purple shirt, but wrong guy.
Did have LJ Wesnaski at least close
Correction.
Enough.
The foul was on number 51.
Grounding.
51 was the foul.
It was Nico Coleman, the center, who had the ball bounce off his shoulder pad. So they back up five, and it's second down and six here for the Great Danes. In plus territory, they've run every offensive play so far from Stony Brook territory. BB Token hangs. Hit at the 25, can't drive four. Gets only about a yard. Good job filling the hole that time by TJ Morrison. So a third and five for Albany. They couldn't convert on the last third down, but Cattuso kept his offense out and they picked it up on four. The weapon they have at field goal kicker in Ethan Stark. This is within his range. It might not be two down territory this time. Under Cutler with a blitz coming. Finds McDonald, who tries to tightrope the sideline but can't stay in bounds long enough to get the first down. Instead, a gain of a couple, and they'll have to try for three more.
Yep, they bring pressure. Quarterback has to get rid of it quickly. McDonald breaks off his route, well short of the first down, and they're going to try a field goal.
McDonald did all he could, just got stuck too close to the sideline. So Stark hit from 43. This one will be from 40. Low snap. And no good. Wide right as the timing was thrown off, and Stony Brook holds.
Only Stark's second miss of the season.
Strong leg, had plenty of distance.
Well, the snap was bobbled a little bit, might have thrown his timing off, and we talked about the weather. Cold footballs are harder, a little bit more difficult to kick. Not sure if that affected Stark that time, but the field goal was no good.
Sussman, the holder, former quarterback, was moved to linebacker this year, also the punter and the holder, so literally a jack of all trades. This is Gowan straight ahead on first down for Stony Brook. Join out to the 26, about a 3 yard gain for the Seawolves.
Talk about Sussman and versatility. Quarterback, holder, linebacker. Conference call this week, Coach Cattuso said he was one of the greatest kids he's ever been around.
He went into summer camp with a legitimate chance to be Albany's starting quarterback. But they had a huge void at linebacker. Cattuso liked his frame, thought he could play the position, and he agreed to switch sides of the ball. Carbone off play action, wants to go deep in and out of the hands of Donovan Washington near midfield. Good throw from Carbone.
Yes, it was. Carbone puts it right on Washington's hands, and he can't come up with the football. Nice read, good route.
It's third down.
Wide open receiver, can't convert.
Stony Brook going quick here on third down and seven. Blitz from Albany. They throw it high for Washington. Pretty good job defensively by Kareem Brown. And Stony Brook has to punt.
Well, communication there with quarterback and receiver. We talked a little bit about Coach Priori in the pregame. This is his alma mater, and this game means a whole lot to him. It's a special place for him to come back. And he didn't anticipate an easy game today because Albany always plays Stony Brook tough.
And McDonald again back to return. They angle the kick, try to keep it away from him. Good job using the sideline. He goes out of bounds right near the 40. So a 34-yard punt, but no return. Chuck Priore, the head coach at Stony Brook. Not a lot of head coaches with time in his background as a strength and conditioning coach, and that might be part of the reason why this is his general football philosophy.
Yeah. You know, he's a hard-nosed guy, an ex-fullback in college. He believes in, again, running the football and stopping the run. And a lot of times teams take on the personality of their coach, and I think that's true here with the Stony Brook Seawolves.
Priore has seen this program come a long way during his tenure. From 20 scholarships to the full allotment of 63. Mo Ford on the counter now changes directions. And Mo Ford, a first down back into Stony Brook territory. So the first time Albany has to run a play on its side of the field, it only takes one snap to get right back across the 50.
Matt, the stats are going to say that it's only a 12-yard run, but that's one of the most impressive runs I've seen all season. The way Mofor was able to dance step and buy some time and get it up the field, incredible display of athleticism by this running back.
Pretty good vision as well to see that the defense had over-pursued on the counter. So first down from the Stony Brook 39. Mo Ford, still the back. Play action. They fake the screen. They want to go deep. What a catch! One-handed Jawan Green. Touchdown, Albany.
You know, it's funny, Matt. You and I were watching pregame warm-ups, and we looked at guys practicing one-hand catches, and we were talking about the gloves and how that aids these catches. But right off the bat, an amazing one-handed catch by Jawan Green puts Albany in front.
Really well-designed play as they bluffed the screen and then went deep to Green, but you can't coach that type of a catch. Start the extra point. And the lead is 7 for Albany.
Well, we'll take a look and watch the play fake there. And a little pump fake by the freshman quarterback. He leads the receiver. Look at the effort there. One hand by Green, pulling it into his body, out racing the defender. That will be one of the better catches of the year in the CAA.
Now, Green had a stretch earlier this season against Richmond and Towson. Successive 100-yard receiving games. Today has had a huge impact. The 49-yard touchdown grab. He also had that long kick return and set Albany up in Stony Brook territory. Great Danes have lived on that side of the field. Three possessions. They've run just one play on their own side, and they've scored two of the three times they've had the ball.
Well, Greg Catuso is an experienced, successful coach. Nothing has gone right for this team this year. We talked about the close calls they've had in losing these conference games. They are ready to play this football game this afternoon.
Catuso and company is spirited effort to this point. See if they try to kick it away from Leontine again. No, they'll give him a chance from the 10. The New York native out across the 25. Got tripped up by Julian Conover. It'll be first and 10 at the 27 for Stony Brook. Joe Carbone made a big play with his legs two possessions ago. That set up a field goal, but also 2-3 and outs for his offense so far. First down for the 27. Leontine straight ahead. Tried to run through a tackle. Couldn't do it. Eli Manser held his ground. Made the stop after a gain of 4.
Albany, 3 very good linebackers. You see Manser, number 12, with the stop. Number 45, Levi Matheny. And number 44, Danny D'Amico. Menser this year, 53 tackles, 4.5 sacks leads the Great Danes in that category.
Last time Albany played a top 10 team in this stadium, it was Eli Menser that sealed the victory over Villanova, returning a fumble 80 yards for a touchdown in overtime. This is Carbone, another keeper. He's got a first down out across the 40-yard line as Joe Carbone doing it with his legs early.
Studied Joe Carbone over the week, saw some videos. Kind of a, remind me of kind of a surfer dude, right? He had the ponytail pulled back, real laid-back guy. And they asked him, why did you go to Stony Brook? And he said, well, it was the only Division I offer that I received. But just another example of quality players that filter through the system and landed in a great spot here.
Football in his blood. Dad played at URI. Play action. Carbone taking a shot deep. And through the fingertips of Julius Wingate, who had a couple of steps on the defense.
Joe Carbone's pass attempt.
Receiver was open.
Julius Wingate.
Ball slightly overthrown.
Time to buy this on the coverage.
Wingate not able to come up with the catch. Watch. Plenty of time. Wingate has a step or two on the receivers. And again, a question of did he see the ball correctly? He looked up. Maybe it's the lights. A couple times now, the receivers seem to have lost the ball in the glare.
Maybe it's the snow in the background, the white background behind the stadium. When you mix it in with the white lights, a little bit tougher. Leontine trying to break a tackle. And again, Menser holding on for dear life. Brings him down after a gain of three, and that'll be the final play of the opening quarter. Albany in a rivalry game looking to pull off the upset. The Great Danes with the fireworks. Juwan Green, the brilliant catch, and it's Albany by 7. Second quarter next. A surprise so far after a quarter. Albany leading Stony Brook 10-3. You see the snow over 8 inches fell last night. But the temperatures have increased. It's cold, but not miserable. Low 40s and dropping here as daylight starts to fade away at Bob Ford Field, campus of the University at Albany. It's the battle for the Golden Apple. Third down for Stony Brook. A win, and they are in the FCS playoffs. A loss. They still probably get in, but they'll have to watch the selection show with a little bit of angst tomorrow afternoon. Joe Carbone and company on third down. Quick throw, first down. Wingate's got it inside the 49 of the 48.
Really good route by Wingate, knowing where the sticks are. Timing perfect. Finds a first down marker, able to get a first down.
It's been an interesting matchup. Wingate against Kareem Brown. We've seen it throughout the opening quarter. Wingate's had to take on a bigger role thanks to all the injury issues at wide receiver for Stony Brook. They had 4 scholarship receivers in his 3 or more games so far this year. First down, Carbone on the move. Going vertical and too high for Donovan Washington, who was open. Got free from Tyler Carswell.
Really had the choice of 3 receivers on that play. Leontine pretty wide open in the flat, and Donovan Washington on the deep route chose the middle receiver, wasn't able to complete it.
So a second down and 10 for Stony Brook. Leontine finds a hole and gets tripped up at the 39. Looked like he might break the shoestring tackle. If he had, might still be running.
Well, according to Coach Priori, Leontine is on the NFL watch list as potential guy getting invited to camp, and you can see why. Hard-nosed player, runs downhill. Love his attitude.
That was going to be a tough tackle for A.J. Missler, the safety in the open field one-on-one with Leontine. Third down and a yard. Leontine bouncing off of contact as a first down at the 38. What a great story, Donald Leontine. Had virtually no interest from D1 schools. He played at a tiny little high school program in upstate New York. Leontine got injured his first 2 years, so was able to kind of build his body, transform it into a D1 frame. And he is turned himself not only into an NFL prospect, one of the best backs in the CAA. This time hit the backfield by Menser. He's going to lose a yard. Nice play from the Albany linebacker.
Menser, good work of sniffing out that play. Straight handoff to Leotine, and simply no place to go. Leotine at only 5'9", but 215. He's got some speed, but he's also got the power to back it up. That's what makes him such a threat.
You'd have to think NFL teams really enjoy that he pretty much plays every facet of special teams as well. He's a return guy, covers kickoffs, covers punts. Carbone on second and 11 finds his target. Alec breaking tackles. And what a move to get the first down at the 27. Marshall Alec.
Pass complete to number 17.
Well, you say move, I say moves. I think he put about three or four pretty good moves on this play. Watch, good route, catches it in his hands. He's able to avoid one, two, three, four tacklers before a couple guys bring him down.
Good call, Ken. I undersold that one a little bit. Very impressive stuff. For the grad transfer from Temple. Leotine, back on the ground. Trying to turn the corner, can't do it. Stop for no gain. Let's go back to that second down pass.
Well, first of all, the route is excellent. You can see by the end zone shot here. And he catches the ball in his hands, and that gives him the ability to run and make these moves. And look at him avoiding all those tacklers.
He made D'Amico, Matheny, and Missler all miss. Those are three pretty good tacklers as well for Albany. That's Matheny, the Bethel Park, Pennsylvania native. Physical downhill linebacker. Second down at 10. Play action, pressure. Carbone hit as he throws, got it away. And got it in the vicinity of Cal Daniels. He was under heavy pressure from D'Amico.
Yeah, D'Amico comes free, pressures the quarterback. Carbone lucky to get that one off. See, good fake, nice camera work by our crew, and D'Amico able to run him down. No place to go with the football.
Dave with the shot that time. Our Fox College Sports crew dealing with some cold conditions for a fourth straight week. Doing a great job through it all. Third down and 10 here. Stony Brook down 7 in the second quarter. Carbone, quick throw, intercepted by Menser. And Menser brings it back into Stony Brook territory.
Joe Carbone intercepted by number 12, Menser.
Well, Albany fighting uphill all year long. Couple of breaks going their way. Watch the job there by number 12. That is Eli Menser, as you said. And he's able to take the ball down the sideline. Now, Menser comes into this game. That's his first interception of the year. Hard to believe that a guy with that kind of ability to catch the ball doesn't have a pick. But it sure comes at a good time.
Menser came to campus as a running back. Switched during the summer before his redshirt freshman year to linebacker. And it's been a good switch. Here's McDonald inside the 40. Tries a couple of spins. Brought down at the 39.
Jeff Undercutler's pass to
gain of about six.
Football's a crazy game. You can see McDonald has had a pretty good year with 25 catches, almost 300 yards, averaging 11.8 yards per catch. But, you know, Albany, nothing more that these seniors would like to do is go out as a winner and beat their rival Stony Brook. And they are really playing well so far into the second quarter.
Second and a long three. Play action up the seam. Nice adjustment, but Green can't hold on as it just slipped out of his mitts.
Jeff Undercutler's pass intended for number 4, Jordan Green.
Now, we'll watch here. Green, when he first gets the football, it looks like he thinks he caught the football. He takes one or two steps. We really can't see by the angle when the ball comes loose, but he gets up and chases the football like he thought it might be a fumble. the official called an incomplete pass.
He was trying to pin it against his shoulder. Some pressure up the middle from Brandon Lopez. Maybe changed the angle on that throw for under Cutler. And forced it behind the target. So now a third down and three. Quick throw, too high for McDonald. And a decision for Catuso and company, and he's already made it. Offense will stay on the field.
Well, you've got that luxury when you're 2-8, and wanting to knock off a rival. They're going to go for it here on what would normally be a punting situation.
They need the 35. Maybe Token Hanks is the back. They blitz under Cutler. Low throw incomplete. A turnover on downs as he was looking for the freshman, Dev Holmes. So Albany, another possession that starts in Stony Brook territory they can't score on as Eli Mencher's interception goes for nothing. Final week of the regular season in the CAA. Congratulations to Maine as they beat Elon 27-26. Clinch a CAA championship. A legend retiring today. Jimmy Laycock's team will need a fourth quarter rally if they want to send him out a winner. JMU trying to get to the FCS playoffs in style. Routing Towson. And in the battle of the blue, Villanova pulls off yet another upset. Maybe spoiling Delaware's season. They beat him at Delaware Stadium 42-21. This is Gowan straight ahead. Here it's Albany 10, Stony Brook 3. About 10 minutes remaining in the opening half. As this entire game, it feels like, Ken, has been played in Stony Brook territory.
It really has. And now you're seeing Gowan's in the game, spelling Leotine. Gowan's nice job of lowering his shoulder and punishing the tackler. Again, of the two, he's known to have the most power. Played a little bit at Boston College, transferred to Stony Brook. He's had a successful career.
Second down at 5. Quick throw to the outside. Almost intercepted again. Kareem Brown driving on the football, knocks it away.
Kareem Brown has been a stalwart at cornerback for Albany. Started all of the games in 2017, 2018. Gets his hands on the football and could have been a pick six.
So third down, gonna get to the 49. Blitz from Albany. They want to go deep up the seam. Almost another one-handed catch, but this one draws a flag as Donovan Washington was jockeying with Ty Tobias.
And Ty Tobias can't believe it. If this call is on him, he ran all the way across the field in disbelief.
Holding. Defense. 10 yards from the previous spot. Automatic. First down.
Let's see it again.
Look at number one, little hand jockeying. Couldn't really see from an angle. Didn't seem like it was much of a hold, but the official had a better angle.
That is not a lot of contact. You're right, hard to see inside the body. First down from the 46 on Albany's side of the field. And pre-snap whistles, flags fly.
Substitution, defense, 12 men on the field, 5 yards, still first down.
So Coach Catuso not too happy about the penalty. We'll take another look. They are tangled up. Now, is that the normal hand fighting between defender and receiver? I can't see an angle there that looks like it's definitively holding, but again, the back judge had the better view and he threw the flag.
Well, that ball's in the air. If you're going to call that contact, it should have been pass interference. Either way, first and 5, and now it's a laundry fest.
False start. Offense. Number 55. 5 yards. First down.
Came to a football game, and a laundry mat broke out as Kyle Nunez cost Stony Brook 5. That's not going to make Chuck Priori happy.
As they say, back to where they started.
Priori, a guy who prides himself a disciplined football team. First down for the 46. Gowans breaking a tackle and diving inside the 40. Got 6 yards back. That'll set up a second down and short. Good job up front.
Yeah, absolutely. The left side of the offensive line, Haynes, Zimmerman, DeTore. Love the way that Gowans runs downhill. Good work on all fronts.
Well, that's how you draw it up on the whiteboard right there. A hat on a hat. Carbone over the middle, has his man. Pelham's inside the 10. It's first and goal, a gain of 31.
Matt, a classic example of how running the football can set up the play action pass. He gets the receiver, Helms, one-on-one on the outside. Tobias not able to break it up. Stony Brook knocking at the door.
That is his first catch of the season. True freshman, football power to Matha. And a short run up the middle. Getting driven back, Gowans, after a gain of 2. Check that, he had 2 last week, had not had a catch before that. So his third catch overall, but still not a guy you're expecting to see make big plays like that.
Yeah, true freshman. Getting some valuable playing time for a pretty good football team.
DeMath, for years, known more as a basketball power under Morgan Wooten, but boy, their football program has really taken off here over the last couple of decades. With Brian Westbrook, DeMath, the high school product, former Philadelphia Eagle and Villanova Wildcat. This is Gowans on second effort, spins his way for a touchdown. Jordan Gowans gets Stony Brook an extra point away from the tie.
Well, there's a reason why these two running backs have rushed for almost 2,000 yards this season. You can see Gowans with the extra effort, smelling the end zone, able to punch it in, and they're a point away from tying this football game up.
Good mental toughness here from Stony Brook in the first half where so many things have not gone right. They are able to draw even. So the defense getting a stop, and the offense turns around and gets a score. Gowans powering his way in to tie the game. Stony Brook drawing even thanks to Gowans' touchdown.
And DeTore trying to block Ibn Foster. Play designed to go to the left, and Gowans cuts it back to the right, and second effort pushes over the goal line.
Number 72, Joe DeTore Jr. out of Falston, Maryland with a big block. This is Green. And this time, much better coverage from Stony Brook after Green and stuck one into Seawolf territory last time. They pin him inside the 25 on this occasion. Casey Williams to stop on special teams. So the Albany offense will run just its second play on its side of the field in the first quarter and a half of this game. Undercutler has been solid so far, but they really let a golden opportunity go by the wayside last time.
Yeah, he's 6-for-10 with 70 yards and a touchdown. Not a bad start.
They fake it on the end around. They flip it to no one, and Albany fortunate to maintain possession. It was Undercutler who eventually fell back on top of it. Looks like they were trying in reverse.
Well, it was an ugly attempt at a gadget play. But look at the penetration by several members of the Stony Brook defense that just absolutely blow that play up.
It's the offensive coordinator, Joe Davis, in his first year coordinating this offense. But Dev Holmes, I'm not sure if he wasn't expecting that pitch or just didn't see it coming. He did not make a big effort going after that ball. Movement up front draws some whistles and more flags.
Offside. Defense, number 96, 5 yards, still second down.
Well, we're going to give some love here to left guard Griffin Clancy, who actually came up out of his stance when he saw the defensive lineman jump, and that's what caused the offside. Really heady play by Clancy.
You have to do it immediately, so nice job to get the reflexes going. Gills in the guilty party and get at least a little bit back after that 9 yard loss on the trick play. See Clancy, one of the anchors of this offensive line. Mole four. A very patient run, just never had a whole pop open. Sincere Malone got him first after a gain of a yard. Had plenty of help from his friends, though.
Interesting that you have the free safety Malone in on that tackle in what should have been an obvious passing down. Second and 12 or 13, you would think they'd be ready for the throw the ball. But Sincere Malone up there sniffing out the run.
Augie Contressa was in there as well for Stony Brook. Malone, very solid tackler. He's played in 33 career games at Stony Brook. Third down, 13. Another blitz over the middle, incomplete. Looking for Green. And Albany will have to punt the football.
Well, Stony Brook has decided that they're going to make this freshman quarterback earn it every time it's an obvious passing situation. They're bringing five or six players rushing the football, and receiver for Albany not able to pick up the first down.
Donovan Washington back to return this punt, a short one. He's got it at the 42. And out of bounds across the 45, 37-yard punt, 4-yard return. So the Stony Brook offense comes back onto the field. Tyrone Wheatley Jr., tight end for this Seawolf team. The name might sound familiar. It should. His dad, Tyrone Wheatley, had a great career at Michigan, was Big Ten Offensive Player of the Year, went on to excel in the NFL, especially in a tenure with the New York Giants. And the younger Wheatley started his career at Michigan before transferring here to Stony Brook.
Well, he's a big guy, this Tyrone Wheatley Jr., 6'6", 295-pound tight end. If you're a cornerback, how'd you like to bring him down?
This is Gowans with some room inside the 40 before Levi Matheny finally brought him down. But that's good for a gain of 17.
You can see that as the game goes on, Stony Brook starting to impose their will, especially up front. The big blockers, the great running backs, now rushed for over 100 yards in this game midway through the second quarter.
Gowans also transferred from Boston College. His brother was a star at Stony Brook. From 08 to 2010 is another flag that cost Stony Brook.
Offense, number 62, 5 yards, first down.
Mason Zimmerman backing up five.
Tight games, you hate to see these types of unforced errors. I know Coach Priori is a disciplinarian. And Carmen Fellis and Chris Bajay, who share the offensive coordinator responsibilities, can't be too happy with these flags.
First and 15 now, Leontine. And he's hit by Matheny, brought down after a gain of three at the 39.
What a year Levi Matheny has had for these Great Danes. 87 tackles coming to the game, 9.5 tackles for a loss, a couple interceptions. Tremendously athletic linebacker.
He's still got a couple of years of eligibility. They're going to be a stalwart for this Albany defense moving forward. Second down at 12. Carbone, another keeper. Nice stutter step move, but a flag is down as they're going to get a hold on Chris Infantino.
Holding. Offense, number 79. 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Still second down.
Easy call when you're out there in space. You see Infantino with the tug on the jersey, and the official has no choice but to throw the flag.
Never a good sign when the shoulder pad pops out from the jersey. Hard for the official to miss that. So now it's Stony Brook going in the wrong direction. All the way back to the 49, a second down and 22. First half bleeding away. A win, and Stony Brook is in the FCS playoffs, no questions asked. A loss, it gets interesting tomorrow. Gowans, short gain to the 46. Another hard hit from D'Amico.
Again, this is something that Stony Brook likes to do and is willing to do. You would think in second and 22, an obvious passing situation, but they've got confidence in this offensive line and these running backs, and they'll take a shot on the ground, second, third, and long.
Stony Brook's got three timeouts. Interesting to see how aggressive they want to be here. Could play the field position game. Try to get the ball back in plus territory. Wheatley wide open inside the 35 to the 34. And the decision got even more interesting after a gain of 12 and an injured Great Dane.
Yeah, they only rush three. They drop eight back into coverage. They play the picket fence, guarding against the first down, and watch the low hit on the big tight end. Stumbles over now. What will they do here? You had mentioned it, Matt. Fourth and about seven. Will they play the field position game, or will they try to go for it?
It's like Levi Matheny might have taken a knee to the helmet that time from Wheatley as he went low, trying to bring down Big Hoss at tight end.
Well, as athletic as Matheny is, he's only 6 foot, 225 pounds. And as you can see, Tyrone Wheatley Jr. is a pretty big fella. They'll bring him to the sideline. He'll go through some concussion protocol, and hopefully the leader of the Great Danes defense will be back.
So Stony Brook will punt the football away. Nolan will try to pin him. Angles it towards the corner and gets a good bounce. Little lob web action as they down it at the 9. Only a 25-yard punt, but excellently done. Three timeouts left for Stony Brook.
Take a look. Punter is happy with his result and gives a little thanks to the guy upstairs. I'm impressed, Matt, that your lob wedge goes backwards, because I usually scull mine right over the green.
Not mine, my friend, not mine. I can't. Now, I've heard about you, Ken. You're just trying to get strokes. I've heard that you're playing at like a 3 or a 4 these days.
Well, I am trying to get strokes. No question.
First down and 10. Everybody at the country club, hear that and remember that. Albany needs to get at least a first down here. Play action. They're going to be aggressive. Going deep. Some contact. And a flag finally comes down as McDonald was being tugged all the way down the field.
Sure, we'll have a look. See if we can tell. It looked to be early contact. Interestingly enough, the side judge, who looked to me to have a better angle, didn't throw the flag. It came from towards the line of scrimmage.
Pass interference. Defense, number 8, 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic, first down.
Augie Contressa.
Contressa, who plays the rover back, kind of a quasi linebacker safety. You'll see it at the bottom of your screen, an obvious hold. Good call by the official.
If you're Contressa, should have let go a little bit sooner. Would have saved 5 yards. It would have been holding instead of pass interference. Either way, first down, and now maybe Albany turns its attention towards trying to score. Certainly an aggressive play call. The deep shot. They've got three timeouts as well. And more movement up front.
False start. Offense, number 75, 5 yards, first down.
The fifth-year senior, Luke Ritter. Costly mistake by an experienced guy. Ritter, a two-time CAA All-Academic Team selection. Ran high school in track.
11 penalties in this game so far.
Feels like more. Here's Mo Ford. Short gain, maybe a half yard, if that. Before Sam Kamara got him. And it'll be second down and 15.
Well, when you're struggling and you're trying to play a clean game, these penalties, just another way that you shoot yourself in the foot. Playing a team that is highly rated in Stony Brook, probably will make a mark in this year's playoffs, and you've just got to tighten it up offensively if Albany wants to win this football game.
Surprised that Stony Brook didn't take a timeout there. Over the middle, Green trying to run after the catch. Contressa got him at the 25. Well done by Augie Contressa. And Stony Brook now will take a timeout with
88
seconds remaining.
First charge timeout, Stony Brook. 30-second timeout.
Yep, good call with the timeout. You want to preserve as much clock as you can, not thinking that Albany may get a first down. They may not. It's third and about nine. You never know. But at least if they don't get the first down, you'll have time to score at the end of the first half.
Green really struggled to secure that, and I think it cost him the opportunity to try to make Contressa miss. Green's got good speed, but hard to run too fast when you're still bobbling the football.
Yeah, he's bobbled it a couple times due to the cold conditions. Contribute to that, hard to say. I never got to wear those big gloves that these guys wear. I don't know how warm your hands stay in those gloves. I know they help you catch the football.
Hey, coming up at the half, we'll get to know Shane Lawless, one of the best defensively in the CAA. Also, Nick Dillon on his senior day for Albany. Plus, we'll have first half stats presented by Geico, and we'll try to take a peek at what the committee might be thinking when it comes to the CAA and the FCS playoffs. Still business here, though. Two timeouts left for Stony Brook, a third and nine for Albany. Blitz hit as he throws, all kinds of contact and all kinds of flags. Jefferson tangled up with Dev Holmes.
Flag comes out.
Pass interference. Defense, number nine. 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Sorry, I stepped on the official there. Saquon Jefferson, guilty of the infraction. And another in a series of penalties for both these football teams.
Jefferson's argument was it was more of a collision than him inducing the contact. See, it's right side of your screen here.
Pretty good shot by our end zone camera. Was contact, and the receiver went down. I think that's a good call.
I agree. I do think Holmes initiated the contact, but Jefferson did a little grabbing. First down from the 40. Under Cuffler, another deep shot for McDonald, and another flag. Eslop was there defensively for Stony Brook.
Pass interference. Defense, number 11. 15 yards from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
The 13th penalty and a half, littered with laundry. And, boy, I don't know about that one. He looked like the receiver almost ran up his back, and the defender is entitled to a path to the ball. I think I disagree with that call.
I hear what you're saying. I think Heslop just didn't sell it well enough because he sealed him and then he slowed up and kind of impeded his path. Got to probably do a little better acting job if you're Heslop. Hit as he throws under Cuffler up for grabs and intercepted. Sincere Malone, a sincerely valuable play here at the end of the first half.
Oh, I was hoping you'd be able to use that sincere line, and Malone comes down with his second interception of the year. Again, the pressure by Stony Brook causes the ball to go straight up in the air. Malone, easy pick. And now Stony Brook has a minute and 8 seconds left in the first half to score.
Looked like Kamara putting the pressure on. Got just enough for the quarterback, and that one was up for grabs.
You're right, Sam Kamara, big-time sack leader for this Stony Brook off defense.
My fault, Ken, breaking a tackle up to the 34-yard line. Gain of six. Boy, pretty conservative here by Stony Brook. I got two timeouts.
I think so. You've got to you got to rush it up to the line of scrimmage. They're letting a lot of time burn off here.
Now remember, they've struggled in the kicking game. Keep it on the ground. Leotine breaking another tackle. He's got a first down to the 41. Gain of 7. And now Stony Brook will take a timeout. Stopping the clock with 36
second charge
seconds.
Timeout. Stony Brook, 30-second timeout.
Well, 32 seconds off the clock with two rushing plays. And that one's a little bit hard to figure out.
Priori, a guy who played his college football here at Albany. We're talking to him this week about how things have changed on the campus. Remember when he was here, it was a D3 program. It started as club football, and he was great. He told us, when I played at Albany, we had to join a local gym in order to get our workouts in.
Yeah, he had some great stories about his playing days at Albany and how much he loves the school. And actually, when Greg Gattuso was looking at the job, he called Chuck Priori, and Priori was one of the guys that convinced him it was a great place to go coach.
How about Priori still donating money to Albany, their rival? Here's a throw, almost intercepted. Kareem Gibson had it in his hands and couldn't hold on.
He sure did. Number 3, Kareem Gibson, breaks on the football right in the breadbasket. Can't pull it in. Would have been his second interception of the year.
Maybe that's why they were keeping it on the ground. They head back that direction. Leotine stopped after a gain of only 1. White made the stop for Albany. Carpone has had some issues turning the ball over today. He could easily have 4 interceptions in his first half, and they're just going to let the clock tick away.
Yeah, Albany had 3 timeouts left. They decide that they're satisfied going into the locker room at halftime, tied 10-10.
Good first half, rivalry game, Empire Classic, in the battle for the Golden Apple. Albany got the first touchdown to take the lead. Jawan Green, Stony Brook responding. Gowans tying it at the half. The last time the CAA got 5 teams in the FCS playoffs was 2011. You see them on your screen. Towson, Old Dominion, who's not in the conference anymore, Maine, New Hampshire, and JMU. In 2018, the conference is a lock, it would seem, to get 5. The question is, can they get 6 into the playoffs? Can Chuck Priori's team, 30 minutes away from nailing down a spot? Maine has an automatic bid. Delaware, Towson, and Elon probably going to have to watch selection Sunday as a bubble mindset, but any or all could get in.
As you look at that list, you have to wonder, will Elon or Delaware be the teams that are on the fence? You would think so. Delaware with a pretty poor end to their season, and you know, Elon with only 6 wins. So we'll have to see what the committee has in store. But certainly all deserving teams to be in the playoffs for sure.
Greg Gattuso is good friends with Chuck Priori. Talked to him before he took the Albany job, but he would like to make Chuck Priori watch that show with some uncomfort tomorrow, because a win by Albany drops Stony Brook to 7-4. And they would be on the bubble as well. We think 3 of the 4 would get in. Maybe all 4, who knows? We'll have to wait and find out. For now, the second half is underway. McDonald on a high hop. Has some speed. Nice cut to the outside. And another good return as Albany will start at the 40.
McDonald, just a good experienced return guy, averaging 17.1 yards per return. And watch, he dekes him inside, and he's got the speed to outrun him on the outside. And good close there by the safety for Stony Brook. But a nice start to this second half for Albany.
Jeff Undercutler. Solid first half. His fourth career game, his third career start. On first and 10, the offense back to work. Ibi Token Hanks gets the direct snap. And out to the 42-yard line. Stony Brook defensive line held its ground pretty nicely. Kamara was there. Along with Brandon Lopez for the Seawolves.
A little wrinkle there by Joe Davis, the offensive coordinator for Albany. We have not seen many direct snaps to the running back this season. They start out the second half with a Wildcat look.
Will Brunson was injured in that main game a few weeks ago. Brunson was the starter most of last season. Vinny Testaverde started much of this season before he also got hurt in that main game. Been under Kepler ever since. Here's Ibi Token Hanks with some room, powering his way into Stony Brook territory, down to the 46. A gain of 12 to move the sticks for Elijah Ibi Token Hanks.
You got to love this kid, Ibi Token Hanks. Watch, takes a simple handoff with some lead blocking, good seal on the outside, and watch how he lowers his shoulder, gains about 8 extra yards on this play. Ibi Token Hanks, a product of Don Bosco High School, which is a football factory in northern New Jersey, picks up a nice chunk of yardage there.
It's a first down at the 46-yard line. More plays in Stony Brook territory. Ibi Token Hanks hit the backfield. Nice job just to get back to the line of scrimmage. Lopez making the stop. Lots of traffic in the backfield that time from the Stony Brook defense.
Yeah, a little delayed handoff that time. Didn't work so well. Too much pressure by the Stony Brook defensive line.
Albany's had 4 trips into Stony Brook territory and has gotten points on only 2 of them. 1 touchdown. Got to take advantage of these chances. Second down and 10. Ibi Token Hanks. Oh, ball slipped free. He'll settle for a gain of 9 as he got tripped up at the 37.
He sure did. Watch the hole that Ibi Token Hanks has to run through. And if it's not for a shoestring tackle, take a look at it. I used to say I could run through that hole. I don't say that anymore. And here they go, quick snap.
And the quarterback sneak gets him the first down inside the 36. Back to that previous play. The old Lombardi seal here, seal there, and up the alley.
And watch right there. Shoestring tackle brings him down. But Albany's got a first down in Stony Brook territory. Now, for the year, they're only averaging 77% scores in the red zone and 43% touchdowns. That's a pretty good percentage.
Try to work to the red zone here. It was Contressa, by the way, that made that shoestring tackle that maybe saved a touchdown when Ibi Token Hanks had the big hole and Catuso has to take a timeout. He is
first charge timeout.
The Albany sideline.
30-second timeout.
Yeah, coaches hate to waste timeouts. They're really like gold at the end of the game. Yeah, some confusion by the offensive unit makes them burn one right here.
Well, we talked about Vince Testaverde being the starter. He was honored before the game today, senior day at Albany. Testaverde's dad, Vinny, had a great college career at Miami. Played first for Howard Schnellenberger. Then Jimmy Johnson took over. So two pretty good coaches. Won the Heisman Trophy in 1986. Elected to the College Football Hall of Fame in 2013. And for his troubles, got sent to Siberia at the time of the NFL, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers.
And Vinny Sr. was here honoring his son, who unfortunately walked out in sweats and not able to play his final game.
Ibi Token Hanks again, trying to bounce free, can't do it, loses a yard. Lawless and McGinty combining on the stop. Vince Testaverde right there on the screen. A big hug from dad, mom as well, as he walked onto the field senior day, his third school. You feel bad for Testaverde. Started at Texas Tech, then he went to Miami, didn't work out there. Comes to Albany, finally gets a chance, was playing pretty well. And then the injury ends his career in the blink of an eye. Second down and 11 is under Cutler. The understudy taking his spot. Ibi Token hangs again, hit the backfield, bounces away, but gets cut down. Heck of a stop that time by TJ Morrison. Holding him to a gain of a couple.
Morrison, who plays the field corner position for Stony Brook, able to bring down Ibi Token Hanks. Nice tackle going low. The big, powerful running back.
Haggard had the initial penetration, forced it wide. That was a do-or-die stop for TJ Morrison, Yonkers, New York native. Third and 10 here for the Great Danes. Bleeding clock in this third quarter.
Stony Brook has been bringing pressure in these situations.
They run it. Ibi Token Hanks. He's got a first down to the 24. What a run by Elijah Ibi Token Hanks.
Matt, they took a page out of the Stony Brook playbook. Take a look here. Running it on third and 10. Caught the Seawolves defense by surprise and able to pick up a first down.
Glad you tried to say that. Stony
three times
Brook
real fast in a cold booth, by the way.
Great play call. And a first down at the 24. It's been the Elijah Ibi Token Hank show on this drive. Play action and too high up the seam. Looking for Dev Holmes, the freshman. They have not had a lot of success finding him.
Yeah, well, Dev Holmes actually had the angle, and that ball, probably the poorest ball that Jeff Undercuffler has thrown all night. That receiver was open. He could have got him the football.
Instead, second down and 10 here. A 5-minute, 15-second drive to start the second half for the Great Danes. And they're just fine with that. Shortening the game against the 10th-ranked team of the country is not a bad thing.
I was just going to say that. When you're an underdog, you try to elongate the game and be in it at the end and try to pull off the upset.
McDonald in motion. Ibi Token Hanks to the outside. Broke a tackle. Tried to spin back. Not going to work. Noah McGinty was there, but had plenty of help from his friends. Heslop and Casey Williams also in the vicinity.
Nice work by number 86, LJ Wisneski, on the down block, but good run support by three members of the Stony Brook defense. Nowhere for Ibi Token Hanks to go.
They're setting an edge, and they're setting a blockade, and they had a blockade set up that time. Third down, Albany has an excellent field goal kicker, so well within the range of Ethan Stark already. Empty backfield for Undercutler. They blitz. He's hit. Buys time. Hit again. Intercepted. Contressa. And Augie Contressa brings it back inside the Albany 30. What a big play.
Huge turn of events in this football game. Credit Undercuffler for trying to make a play. Good work by getting away from the pass rush. And the ball floats harmlessly in the air. Contressa picks it off. It looks like he's going to go to the house. I think the turf monster got him here at the end because there was nobody really touching him. Well, he might have got his leg clipped there by his own player.
Shane Lawless with the tackle.
Seawolves now with an opportunity.
What a huge swing. First down at the 29. Leotine inside the 25. Got almost five. Augie Contressa, two-time captain and all Long Island and third-team All-State selection during his high school days. Redshirted his first year on campus, played every game last season, and has started each this year. Second down. Leotine again. And Leontine spinning near the first down of the 20. Boy, does he run the football hard.
He really does. You can hear the pads popping all the way up here in the press box. Leontine just time after time lowering his shoulder, making the would-be tackler pay.
They're going to go quick. Well, it looked like they might. Carbone now looking over to the sideline. Albany's defense showed the Seawolves something, so they changed the play. Leontine, first down to the 17. Gain of 3, just pushing Albany off the line of scrimmage.
Well, they make it look easy, but the impressive part is there's 8 guys at the line of scrimmage, and they're still able to gain 2 or 3 yards to make a first down. You think it's easy, but what a great job by that offensive line to create that hole.
Leontine again, this time hit and stopped at the line of scrimmage for no gain. Fantastic defensive effort by Danny D'Amico, who's had himself a nice game.
He really has. D'Amico, part of these linebacking, athletic linebacking core for Albany, called his name several times tonight.
Another local product, Manlius, not too far here from Albany, Bob Ford Field. Leontine, a steady diet, breaks a tackle, and bulldozes to the 10. Gain of 7, it's third and short.
You mentioned Bob Ford Field. He is up here in the press box with the ever-present cowboy hat, a local legend here. I don't think they're ever going to name a field after me, and I admire anybody who has one named after them.
I thought that's what they called your backyard football field. It injured Great Dane will take a break. 6:09 to go in the third. Stony Brook and Albany tied, but the Seawolves are driving. Big day for the Dudzinski family. That's Keith, the associate head coach, defensive coordinator. His son Jack celebrating senior day, an offensive lineman. Keith looking to get a stop for his defense here on third down and 3. Leontine, the fake, Carbone O'Keefe breaks a tackle, dives, and it'll depend on the spot. Looks like he's got it. First down at the 7. Another good ball fake from Joe Carbone.
Carbone is a guy who's not known for his running, averaging 0.3 yards per rush coming into this game. He had a huge run to start the football game, is able to turn the corner.
Wisniewski went to go tackle Leontine. That got the step for Carbone. Only the second possession of this second half. Leontine straight ahead. Nice tackle to save the touchdown by Missler.
Well, you're right. A.J. Missler with a one-on-one tackle that saves the touchdown. Not an easy guy to break down is Donald Leontine. Missler able to bring him down short of the goal line. Nice work.
He almost got that football out, too. Saw Leontine secure it there as he was going down at the last instant. Second down and goal. Leontine hit and stopped. Maybe a half yard. Big stick.
That's number 55, Brady Wisniewski. Remember, Levi Matheny went out of the game in the second quarter. Looked like some type of a possible head injury or concussion, but Wisniewski coming up with the fill.
And now it's third down and goal. Plenty of time on the play clock here. Carbone for the end zone. High for Leontine, and it's fourth down. Although a flag is down. Interesting decision here.
It really is.
Pass interference. Offense. Number 19. 15 yards from the previous spot. Still third down.
Julius Wingate, the call.
They're going to bring him back, and I agree with this. You want to push him back outside the 10-yard line. Again, this team is much more known for its rushing prowess then it's passing prowess. If you leave them at fourth and two, they may decide to go for it anyway and score. So I agree with this call by Albany.
That must be what it was. Catuso must have thought Stony Brook would have gone for it. So now third down and goal. It's a keeper. Carbone, plenty of space. Touchdown.
Touchdown, Stony Brook. And becomes Jay Carbone.
Greg Catuso elects to take the penalty, and Stony Brook makes him pay.
Wow. The element of surprise. We've said it several times this afternoon. Carbone, not known as a running quarterback. He's got over 66 yards rushing in this football game, and I'm sure Albany didn't anticipate that.
And the Seawolves back in front. Low snap, nice job to get it down. And the lead up to 7. Carbone on 3rd and goal from 17 yards. And the Seawolves up 7. Chuck Priori's team taking the lead 17-10 on a Joe Carbone touchdown run. This emotional game for Priori, who played his college football at Albany. He was a co-captain on the 1982 team along with one of his best friends, Jerry Wisbecki. Wisbecki loves seeing Priori coach against their alma mater. He would come visit the Stony Brook head coach in the hotel the night before the game. He would bring him some of Albany's trademark wings. Unfortunately, Wisbecki passed away last year, and Priori said he was really going to miss seeing his friend before the game, but was looking forward to catching up with his family, who would be here. And certainly one of those things, if you're Priori, how tough this can be emotionally as McDonald weaves his way out to the 28-yard line. I mean, here's a guy that still gives money to the Albany football program, even though he coaches their rival. He gave Greg Catuso some advice to take this job, and it means a lot to him.
Yeah, another example of football is much more than wins and losses. It's relationships. It's, you know, supporting the place that you love, that you played for. And even though he's in a competing team in the same conference, he still supports the University of Albany.
Albany needs to move the ball here from the 28. Moe 4 moving the pile out across the 30 to the 31, a gain of 3. It'll be 2nd down and 7. Lawless the stop for Stony Brook.
This game has been kind of a microcosm of the season. Albany has had several chances. Stony Brook's end of the field, and either a penalty or an untimely turnover, if there is such a thing as a timely turnover. And they just haven't been able to get over the hump. Still in this football game, only down by 7, with 3.5 minutes to go in the third quarter.
Timely turnover, 3rd and 30. You throw an interception 40 yards down
there
the field.
There you go.
Got your back, partner.
Thank you.
2nd down at 7. Again, the back moves to take the direct snap. Moe 4. And he's going nowhere. What an effort. Breaking multiple tackles across the 35 to the 37. That's as good a 6-yard run as you're going to find.
Well, I saw the best 12-yard run of the season. Now I've seen the best 6-yard run. Now look at this. He is dead to rights. Mofor has no place to go but some fancy footwork. He's able to escape several tackles and make something out of virtually nothing.
Not good for this profession, but I'm left speechless by that run. 3rd yard. Now they move under Cuffler, under center. See if he sneaks it here. Try to hard count. Give to Moe for great jump cut. The pile moves just enough for a first down, all the way out to the 41. We started with a jump cut, and we ended with a rugby scrum.
Sure did. The jump cut buys him some time, and the extra effort at the end of the run gets him the first down. Take a look. A little avoidance of the initial tackler. Now the rugby scrum, and watch the effort continuing to drive your legs, getting the first down. That's some good stuff.
And that whole offensive line helping to move the pile as well. Both were averaging 4 yards a carry. First down from the 41. Counter. Spinning and not going to get back to the line of scrimmage. Lost a couple. Here, Malone and Lawless combining on the stop.
Talking about a great run from Tressa.
Well, Albany in the first half was able to stay ahead of the sticks. A lot of third shorts. Has not been the case as often here in the second half.
Well, certainly they've decided to run the football much more than they did in the first half. Undercuffer's only thrown 15 passes thus far in this ballgame.
Second down and 12. Take it to Mo four. Undercuffer's got lots of room. First down into Stony Brook territory.
Jeff Undercuffer, the ball carrier.
Out of bounds at the 49. Nice job by the freshman.
Yes, it was. Wide open space as he had number 83, Donovan McDonald, blocking for him on the outside. If Undercuffer sees this, he may have been able to turn this up and gain a few extra yards, but he's happy to get it out of bounds and gain the first down.
I like that he did not pull the trigger on the throw to Dev Holmes as he was scrambling. Holmes popped open, but that would have been a tough toss on the move. Move the stick. And he did it with his leg. Another play action fake. Another run for Undercuffler. And another nice gain of first down at the 39.
With Undercuffler's okay.
Back-to-back scrambles for first downs. Undercuffer showing some good judgment and athleticism. These are big plays here by Albany to try to get back in this football game.
That's the end of the third quarter. Undercuffer doing it with his legs on this drive. It was Carbone on third and goal, the 17-yard score. 10th-ranked Stony Brook up 7 going into the final quarter. Cool shots last night, the time lapse, 8 inches of snow, and then a lot of work from the folks at Albany to clear the playing surface and get it ready. Give credit to our engineer in charge, Justin Stansel. Brave the cold conditions to get this shot, and look at all the work to get the field ready for play. They had to move a lot of snow. 8 inches fell yesterday.
It's a great point of how hard our crew works. Getting time-lapse photography last night to get here 6 hours early prior to game time. I know as broadcasters, we really appreciate the work that the guys in the truck do and all the cameramen. It's been a great team effort here this season.
As indeed. On first down, Carl Mulford getting the call, dragging a defender for 3 to the 36. Also credit to Mark Balk, our fearless producer. Working through his beloved Syracuse Orange, getting the holy heck beaten out of them by Notre Dame. Here's our third quarter stats. Pretty impressive stuff from Stony Brook on the ground.
Yep, 175 yards rushing. They average 208 yards for the season, so they're right on track. But Albany sneaking up stats-wise, and they have the ball into Stony Brook territory, only down a touchdown.
Second down and 7. Mo for again, collided with his offensive lineman and then got snowballed under. An avalanche of Stony Brook defenders. Noah McGinty and Lawless led the charge.
Noah McGinty, one of these heroes of this Stony Brook defense, 78 tackles, 6 tackles for a loss. He actually had 14 tackles in the season opener against Air Force this season.
Sean Kennedy went to pull there, Ken, and his fellow lineman got knocked in his path. Mofor had to push Kennedy out of the way. Third down and 10. Another blitz. Undercuffer goes down. Casey Williams sacks him back at midfield.
Bobby McIntyre, the defensive coordinator for the Seawolves, dialing up pressure in obvious passing situations. A stunt, absolutely not enough blockers to protect the quarterback. Looks like he took a bump on the head there at the end.
I'm sure they will check on him. Nick Burns is the backup quarterback. Here's the punt. Not Sussman this time. That was Ethan Stark, and that ball's out of bounds at the 24. Only a 26-yard punt. Stony Brook gets it back. A win, and they're in the playoffs. They lead by 7 in the fourth quarter. The band played on. As you can see, a little chilly here at Albany, but the Great Dane faithful keeping hope alive in this game. Trailing by 7 to the 10th-ranked team in the country. Early fourth quarter. Defense really needs a stop here. Carbone and company for the 24. The give to Gowans. Gowans hit immediately and gets a yard. That is it before he's driven back. And a flag comes down late. Dolce and Casal were both there. And it got chippy.
Sure did. The last thing you want to do when you're winning a football game is take a needless penalty. Albany trying to pull their players out of there.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Offense, number 23. Half the distance to the goal. The down counts. Second down. This is number 23's first unsportsmanlike foul of the game.
It's going to be second and 22.
Jordan Gowans taking exception to what he felt was some unnecessary contact after the whistle, but you can't do that.
You cannot. That's a good call. That is also a fantastic piece of Bugs Bunny acting right there from Casal. A one-handed left arm shove from Gowans moved him 10 feet back and sent him sprawling to the deck. Well done by Casal.
The drama department here at Albany would be proud.
Whatever it takes to draw the flag, and now way behind the sticks, Stony Brook. Priori asking for an explanation from the officials. Carbone, a career high with his 66 yards on the ground. Not his best day in the air, though. A couple of mistakes and 63 passing yards total as the officials still trying to get everything squared away.
As they sort it out, you know, we're in an open air booth here and it is a little bit chilly. I got to give a shout out to our stats guy, Jason, who has been bringing me hot tea all evening long, which will let me enunciate these words because it's chilly up here.
Yeah, you're at least 5 teas in at this point. Gowans looking for some redemption, finishes that run out across the 20 to the 21, a 9-yard pickup, but still third and long. Pent-up frustration as he lowered his shoulder. And A.J. Missler made the tackle but paid for it. This is an important play. Third down. They need the 34-yard line. Want to get the first down, but most importantly, can't afford to turn it over here. You have a 7-point lead and your defense playing well. And consequently, they keep it on the ground. Carbone goes down. Antoine White defends the zone read perfectly.
Yes, he did. Antoine White was not going to get fooled by that quarterback keeper again. White, a Penn State transfer and a guy that the NFL may be interested in. Nice job of recognition bringing down Carbone.
They got him with that play 3 times as Carbone pulled it out and kept it, including the 17-yard touchdown on third and goal, but not that time. McDonald back to return. The punt from Nolan. Nolan, a short kick. McDonald. Oh, it hit off a Great Dane. And Albany ends up with it, and they get excellent field position as you hear the exhale from the Albany sideline.
Albany very fortunate to maintain that football. When the punt is short, you have a Peter call out there, which means get away from the football. And apparently there was some miscommunication. The ball was touched by Albany, and they are very fortunate to get that football back.
The It hit off the helmet of Sussman. Collette made a fantastic recovery as that looked like it bounced right to Stony Brook. So another possession, fourth of the game for Albany that starts in Stony Brook territory. Play action. Under Cuffler. Stops and throws it low, incomplete. Got rid of it at the last instance. He was under heavy pressure right from the start. Kamara chasing after him for Stony Brook.
Yeah, I thought Under Cuffler might tuck this and run like he did a couple times in the third quarter. He decides to try to get rid of football at the last second. Falls harmlessly to the ground, incomplete. But this is an area of the field, Matt, where Albany really has to make their presence known here. They're not going to get that many more opportunities. And I would not be surprised if it's four down territory for the rest of this football game.
11 and a quarter minutes remaining. We're in the fourth quarter. Bibby Token Hanks clogged up. Had to work hard to just get a yard. Kamara and Gilzine got in there. It's third and nine.
More pressure by the front seven of Stony Brook. They seem to be playing more and more in the offensive backfield of Albany. Good gang tackling there, bringing down a guy that's not that easy to take to the turf.
I agree with you. You would think two down territory here potentially, unless they want to play the field position game one more time. Maybe Token Hand switches sides, gets the call, has some room. It closes quickly, and he's driven back by E.J. Finneran. A gain of only three, and it's fourth and six.
Number 14, E.J. Finneran, with another excellent one-on-one tackle. Watch how he sticks his helmet right in the midsection, drives him back, brings down Ebi Token Hanks. You know, Finneran, 6'4", 225. That's a big guy to be playing strong safety.
Albany is 1-for-2 today on fourth down. 3-for-6 on the season. From the 36, it's 4th and 6. Under Cuffler throws wide open, dropped, a turnover on downs. Tim Voorhees couldn't hold on.
Boy, you got to feel sorry for Albany in a season there. The breaks have not gone their way. A wide open receiver drops a potential first down. And off we go with only 9:35 left in this football game.
It's simple for Stony Brook. If they win, they're in the FCS playoffs. If they lose, they might still be. You see Tim Voorhees on the screen. He dropped the fourth down pass. Stony Brook gets the ball. Maine won the CAA championship earlier today. The Seawolves, though, looking for win number 8 as Leontine charging past the 40 to the 41, a gain of 5. If Stony Brook wins, they watch the selection show tomorrow for fun to find out where they play. If they lose, it's a lot less fun experience, something that they'll be experiencing at Elon, Towson, and Delaware tomorrow. Second down and 6. Leontine straight ahead, drilled, and fought his way up to the 45, a gain of 4. So Leontine's been solid, but the guy today on the ground has been Joe Carbone.
Well, certainly pulling a rabbit out of their hat. Carbone, not known for his rushing ability, two long runs. He's got 63 yards rushing and a touchdown in this football game, and that was unexpected by the Albany defensive staff.
Huge play here. Third down and a short 2 at the 45-yard line. Leontine barreling ahead. Got the first down out near the 48. And that'll allow the Seawolves to grind some more clock.
So when we talked to Coach Priori, he talked about you know, wanting to play old school football, being able to run the football. Well, this is where it pays off. When you've got a lead late in the ball game and you can get first downs by chewing up the clock, you know, rushing 3, 4, 5 yards a carry, it's so valuable.
And that's why he rotates bodies in and out on the offensive line. He says we have 7 guys worthy of being starters. Keep everybody fresh and beat on teams. Leontine pounding away into Albany territory to the 48. Gain of 4.5.
You see Leontine. He's got 67 yards on the night. Gowan 63. A total of approaching 200 yards rushing, which is right about on their average.
Became the 11th Seawolf all-time to rush for over 1,000 yards last week, padding the total here today. Second down and 6. Leontine hit, spins to the 45. Got 3 more. It'll be 3rd and short.
And there you see just a little zone blocking scheme. All of the linemen just kind of putting their shoulders together, blocking en masse. And Leontine, another good job of running downhill, gaining a few yards. There wasn't a whole lot there.
Remember, Albany had to burn a timeout early. Carbone comes off. Tyquell Fields into the ball game. Tyquell Fields, the sophomore, Yonkers, New York. A little modern wishbone look here. Out of the shotgun. Fields, the keeper, and he's hit at the line of scrimmage. So Stony Brook goes deep into the playbook, maybe outthinks itself a little bit. It's 4th down.
Just about what I was going to say. Sometimes you wear a seersucker in the winter, you outsmart yourself, right? Fields comes into the game, hasn't taken a snap all game long, come up short, now they've got to punt the football. This is an area, though. Watch out for the fake punt.
From the 45, Nolan kicks it away. McDonald, the fair catch at the 14. A 31-yard punt. Albany gets it back. Down by 7. Just under 6 minutes to go. This is the battle for the Golden Apple Trophy. 2 years ago, a defensive slugfest, much like we've had today, was won by Albany. A defensive score, the difference. They took it 13-6, and then last season, a bunch of haymakers thrown by both teams. But it was Carbone throwing the game-winning touchdown pass in overtime, and a Seawolf celebration. They brought the cup back to Long Island. Both coaches, they want the trophy. Truck Priori, he needs the trophy to make sure his team's headed to the playoffs. Under Cuffler, gonna go deep. Got a man behind the defense. Washington McDonald, I should say. He's gonna go touchdown. Donovan McDonald from 86 yards.
Hello. Albany struggling on offense here in the second half. Throws a haymaker. Donovan McDonald down the sideline. A bomb for a score. Point away from tying up this football game. What a play.
Lightning strikes. McDonald, the former sprinter at Nebraska, racing past the defense for the score. And his teammates loving it. The extra point. No good! And Stony Brook still up a point.
Matt, that's just unbelievable. You've got Ethan Stark, maybe the best kicker in the entire conference, missing an extra point after a spectacular play, and Albany trails by 1.
Coming into today, Stark had missed 2 kicks all year. 1 field goal, 1 extra point. He's missed 2 today. A field goal and a PAT. None bigger than that.
Just incredible. Season that's gone so wrong for Albany here. They pull off a big. Now, watch here. It starts with the protection. Watch the poise of this quarterback The defender falls down, and McDonald's able to catch that in stride, and you're not going to catch him. So you go from joy to the sorrow of missing an extra point, and Albany still trails in this football game.
Well, here's the kick.
Nothing wrong with the hold.
Just pulled it. He knew it right away. Now he'll kick off. Still 5:32 to go. Two timeouts remaining for Albany. The defense will have to get another stop. Leontine from inside the five. Going to let it go. Now he's going to bring it out. And he's going to pay for it. Does not get to the 15. I'm not sure if he thought he was outside the end zone or what happened, but the decision didn't work out. First down at the 15 for Stony Brook.
You want to look at that play. Leontine, a little confusion there. Wasn't sure whether or not he should bring him out. He decides to, a number 47, Julian Conover, I believe is the guy who lays a wicked shot on Leontine, drops him right to the ground. Pretty good play by kickoff coverage guy.
Gowans on first down. Runs into his offensive lineman. Albany tries to strip him. Can't get it free. A gain of 6 to the 21. The clock will tick under 5 minutes before the next snap.
Number 62, Mason Zimmerman, almost got called for another unsportsmanlike conduct play. These guys got to keep their poise. They've got the lead.
So a second down and 4. Still 18 on the play clock. They snap it there. Gowans near a first down as a penalty is down. He's a yard short. I'll have to check the marker.
That's a good pickup by you, Matt. When you've got the lead late in the ball game, you want to run that play clock.
There is no foul for formation. Result of the play is third down.
You want to run that play clock down close to zero. They snapped that with, as you said, 18 seconds to go, and those may be valuable seconds for Albany at the end of the football game.
What a pivotal play this is. Third down and a yard. Albany got the quick strike last time, not necessarily built to score in a hurry, though. They do bleed the play clock down this time.
Single coverage on the outside if they want to take a shot.
Instead, it's to Gowans, and he will not get the first down. Carswell got into the backfield and got the stop.
Matt, Albany's defensive coordinator Joe Bernard and Keith Dudzinski put all their cards on the table. They put 9 guys at the point of attack. They had 2 cornerbacks covering 2 wide receivers. Look at the penetration to bring down Gowans. That's a heck of a defensive play and a great call by the defensive staff.
So Albany rises up again. Another punt. The best of the day this time. And McDonald makes the fair catch at the 37. So a 39-yard punt. Albany down a point, 3:41 to go. As Keith Dudzinski's defense got to stop. And now the Albany offense, they don't need a touchdown. A field goal would do it.
Yeah, there you see Joe Bernard on the sideline. They're co-defensive coordinators. But if you're Albany, is a great situation to be in. You're down a point, 3.5 minutes to go, 4 down territory the rest of the way. They've got a chance to win the football game.
Bernard was the offensive coordinator last year, switched over to the defensive side of the ball. Has done a nice job working with Dudzinski. First down, under Cutler, over the middle, and it's a short gain to Holmes. Pickup of 2 to the 39. Lawless, another stop for Stony Brook.
Forget about the clock. There's 3:27 to go. It really doesn't matter. They're in 4 down territory. As I said, it's all about downs, making first downs, and getting into field goal position.
And remember, they have one of the best kickers in the CAA, even though he's having a rough day. Bowl 4 bouncing it to the outside, turns it up. into Stony Brook territory, out of bounds at the 45. A gain of 16 for the Great Danes.
Stony Brook's defense loses contain on the outside. Running back's able to bounce it out. Get some extra yards up the sideline. Good work by the Albany offense.
Stark has hit from 51 this year. They would need another 11 yards to get him within that range. Bowl four, big hole up the middle. Nice move inside the 20. A gain of 28.
Tackle number 35, Shane Morris. And that'll be a first down.
Watch the job of this offensive line. Another gaping hole. And Carl Mofor takes it right up the gut. They are well into field goal range. 2:18 and counting. Now, keep in mind, Stony Brook has all three timeouts left. They may want to start thinking about using them.
I agree. Beaufort's had a fantastic day. Sophomore, pressed into service last year, got valuable reps. Gets it again. Trying to get to the corner. And he is thrown out of bounds. With 1:51 to go, that'll stop the clock after gain of only a yard.
I think that's a situation where you probably want to try to stay in bounds to keep the clock moving, make Stony Brook burn one of those timeouts.
Finneran was able to get him to the sideline, and you're so right, Ken. That's a nice play by Finneran. Kind of guided him to the boundary. Stark, he's hoping for another chance. This missed extra point, the reason why Albany trailing by a point. Second down. Mole four. Touchdown, Albany! And the Great Danes back in front with 1:45 to go.
Well, Matt, as you know, we don't root for any particular team. So when a team like Albany, who's had so much go against them this season, they fight back against a quality opponent like Stony Brook and Mofor. What a second half he has had. I think that puts him close to the 100-yard marker in this football game. And that's a big touchdown because now Stony Brook is going to have to go the length of the field, not just settle for a game-winning field goal.
Now an important two-point conversion because if they get it, a touchdown would only tie. The reverse tried to throw, and McDonald did not get much on it. Mofor was covered. They tried the Philly special, and that one didn't work out so well. Well, Greg Catuso's team does not get the two-pointer, but they got the touchdown they needed.
Yep, Mofor, another good decision, bouncing it outside, and literally untouched into the end zone. So the scenario is Stony Brook down by 5, 1:45 to go. They've got all three of their timeouts. And this has been a very entertaining football game.
Carl Beaufort, 95 yards. That was his fifth touchdown of the season, but none more important. That effort, which gave his team a 5-point lead, the Empire Classic, in a battle for the Golden Apple Trophy. Well, more importantly for Stony Brook, maybe their playoff lock.
Albany has rushed for 156 yards against a very good rush defense. Stony Brook only averages giving up 119.8 per game.
Lead team back to return. He'll get a shot from the 11. He drops it, picks it up, breaks a tackle, and fumbles. Albany has it at the 30.
Incredible. Albany sideline going crazy. A couple of bounces finally going their way. Leotine, such a great player for this Stony Brook offense and kick return team.
A.J. Nisler recovered it. Leotine can't believe it.
Now remember, Stony Brook does have three timeouts. As we look at the play, Leotine trying to make something happen. They need to score a touchdown. Good job of poking the football out. Albany jumps on it. Now I would assume that they're going to try to rush the football three times, keep the ball on the ground, and a first down will win it for the Great Danes.
Stony Brook can stop the clock three times, but they're in field goal range. Ebi Tolkien Hanks pushes the pile to the 26. Gain of two. Timeout, Stony Brook with 9 seconds.
First charge timeout, Stony Brook. 30-second timeout.
Here's how important this game is. You look at the CAA standings, which we're going to put up here in a second. Stony Brook entered this game 7-3 overall, 5-2 in conference play. They started the afternoon with a chance to win the conference. Maine ended that chance when they beat Elon earlier this afternoon. A win, and Stony Brook is in the playoffs, no questions asked. A loss, and they're going to have to watch the selection show tomorrow, along with Delaware, which lost today, Towson, which lost today, and Elon, which lost today, all sitting there with 4 setbacks on the season. Beaufort back in, gets the handoff, and there's nothing there. Stopped at the line of scrimmage, no gain, and another timeout for Stony Brook with 1:23.
Second charge timeout, Stony Brook, 30-second timeout.
Meanwhile, Albany, they're winless in CAA play, trying to get on the board, but it's that muddled mess. Maine's in, James Madison's in. Stony Brook, Towson, Delaware, Elon. You could get all 4 in. You could get 2 of 4. You could get 3 of 4. I think the CAA would tell you they'll get a minimum of 3. They'll hope for 4, but that's going to be a tough decision for the selection committee.
Well, it's hard for us to be objective because we really only see CAA football. We don't have a handle on the other conferences, but certainly there are 5 or 6 deserving teams. And Stony Brook, if they don't make the playoffs, I really think that would be an injustice.
They beat Delaware last week. A false start, movement up front. Luke Ritter, the fifth-year senior.
False start. Offense, number 75, 5 yards, still 3rd down.
Delaware has wins over Towson and Elon. Towson has a win over Elon. Elon probably has the best win of the bunch over James Madison. The whole thing is a mess. I would not want to have that job on the committee. And remember, they're not comparing just the CAA teams. They'll compare them to the Missouri Valley Conference and everyone else. 3rd down. Moore almost snuck through, but he got valuable yardage back. A gain of 5. Last timeout used by Stony Brook.
Final charge timeout, Stony Brook. 30-second timeout.
If they can hit a field goal here, they can't lose in regulation.
Well, the penalty hurts them there. That 5 yards, it would have created a 3rd and very short. And who knows, they may have gone for the 1st down and tried to seal the deal. Right now, they have to settle for a field goal to go up by 8.
Ethan Stark has missed 2 kicks today. 1 field goal, 1 PAT. Injured Seawolf is E.J. Finneran as he's helped over to the sideline. But Stark's an excellent kicker. He's only missed 4 kicks all year long. The Albany coaching staff got Stony Brook to use all 3 of the timeouts, and now if they hit this field goal, can't lose in regulation. From 44, No good. So the nightmarish evening continues for one of the best in the CAA, and Stony Brook gets it back down 5 with a buck 12 to go.
Kick hits the upright. Unreal. Looked like he hit it really solid. I thought he made it. And as he's looking, he's saying, oh, are you kidding?
All right, if you're Stony Brook, no timeouts. Got a senior quarterback. Haven't done much in the passing game today. Needs 74 yards and 72 seconds. Carbone over the middle. Wingate trying to get to the sideline and does. Good job. Block more valuable than a couple of extra yards. He'll settle for 8.
Yeah, if you're a receiver for Stony Brook, you're looking for the sideline on every play. Of course, the clock stops for every first down, which gives you a little bit of leeway.
Carbone, a four-man rush. Over the middle, incomplete, in and out of the hands of Pellens. Draped all over him was Gibson defensively.
Job on pass coverage, knocking the ball away at the last second.
Let's start down with Rick James on the defense.
Third down and 2. Three-man rush. Carbone going to go deep. Helms got knocked down, and that'll draw the flag. A.J. Missler's had a big game, but not sure why he drilled Delonte Helms.
Well, if he thinks he's beat, then it's really not a bad penalty, because if the guy's going to go untouched down the sideline, maybe that was his thinking. I'm not sure.
Defense, number 41. Ball be placed in the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
Hit him like a missile that time.
They're going cover 2 because they want to protect the sideline. Now, you can see right there, he may have thought he was beat and he had to stop the receiver. Not sure exactly if that was his mindset, but it wouldn't surprise me.
Good point. So the ball to the 48. 55 seconds to go. Carbone and company need 52 more yards. Trailing by 5. Another three-man rush. Carbone on the move for Washington off his fingertips.
Nice job by Carbone, buying some time, finding a receiver down the sideline, just can't come up with the catch. Watch, extends the pocket. He's got a little crack there to get that in. Washington comes up short.
No timeouts, 49 seconds remaining. Second down and 10 for Stony Brook. Carbone stepping up, gets rid of it, caught, Wingate. And he's got a first down, which will stop the clock temporarily with 41 seconds to go. Priori wants to spike it. And they kill the clock with 38 seconds remaining at the Albany 41.
That last play, that was nice work by Julius Wingate, knowing where the first down marker is, coming back to the football. His forward progress gave him the first down. They kill the clock with 38 seconds to play.
A second down and 10. A rough day for Carbone, but he can erase all of that. And he throws it high, and probably fortunate that he did so. Was looking for Wingate. Kareem Brown might have picked an accurate ball.
Albany playing straight coverage defense, only rushing 3. 8 men back in coverage. They're not going to let anybody get behind them. They want to force Stony Brook to throw it underneath. Hopefully stop the ball in play and chew up some clock.
34 seconds remaining. Carbone bouncing to the outside. Throws it for Wheatley, incomplete. 26 seconds remaining. It's 3rd and 10. Oh, I beg your pardon. It's 4th and 10. 4th and 10.
So this is it. Here's the ball game. They got to get a first down, or Albany gets their first conference win of the season.
They need the 31 to keep this game alive. Garbone stepping up, going deep. Wingate! Touchdown! Are you kidding me? Julius Wingate, the fifth-year senior.
Matt, this was, for all intents and purposes, a Hail Mary. Carbone, running for his life, throws it into the end zone. Wingate does a great job, like a basketball player, making himself big, keeping the defender on his back, boxing out, comes up with the football. Absolutely incredible.
The ruling on the field is a touchdown. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct against the offense, number 88, he removed his helmet. That 15-yard penalty will be assessed on the kickoff.
On 4th and 10, a 41-yard touchdown, and Chuck Priore's team is 17 seconds away from cementing its ticket to the postseason.
Take a look. Hail Mary, right? Now watch the receiver get in front of the defender, boxes out like a power forward on the basketball team, comes down with the football. And incredibly, looks like Stony Brook is going to win this game.
A two-pointer to make it a three-point lead. Leotine driving and doesn't look like he got there. No good. So the two-pointer fails. 17 seconds remaining. This will be a kickoff from back at the 20. Maybe Albany can get lucky back to the touchdown.
Watch, Carbone steps up in the pocket, just heaves it, and a la Aaron Rodgers, there's a miracle in Albany. Take a look, great angle by our cameraman. Look, now a little push off there by the receiver, no call by the official. He's able to get in front of the defender, come down with the football.
Nudge Tyler Carswell out of the way. But he did a good job, didn't extend those arms, just kind of moved them. And Wingate, what a turn of events for Stony Brook.
I would expect to see a squib kick here. Donovan McDonald is a very dangerous return guy. I don't think he's going to get the chance. With only a few ticks left on the clock, it's going to take two miracles.
Two timeouts remaining for Albany. If you squib it, if you're the Great Danes, if you can attack the ball and grab it as fast as possible, maybe be a throw or two away from potentially field goal range.
Exactly, a squib. If you get the ball around midfield, you take a couple shots in the end zone. Wouldn't that be something? Back-to-back Hail Marys.
You know, Ethan Starks hoping for a shot at redemption for Albany. McDonald and Mofor back hoping for a chance. They do squib it at the 40. And great field position here for Albany. All the way to the 42 goes Missler. That's exactly what you had to worry about. And now, remember, on a tough day for Stark, he has a 51-yarder this year. You're only 9 yards from that.
You're right. They don't need a touchdown. A field goal wins this football game. So you can take a shot or two. Albany still has two timeouts remaining. And they're only about, what would you say, about 10 yards from field goal range? Incredible.
If they get to the 35, they try. That's one completion. Four-man rush. Under Kopfler over the middle, Moe four, and they're in field goal range at the 31. Timeout with 4 seconds remaining.
Second charge timeout.
Well, they're going to send the field goal unit out. There's no question that
timeout.
Ethan Stark is going to get a chance to redeem himself, and wouldn't this be justice? The best kicker in the CAA who's had a difficult night has a chance to win the game for Albany.
Ofer, good job, just get as much as he could and give Stark a chance. Here's a kid all year. He had missed two kicks, one field goal, one extra point. Today, he's missed three.
Now, the wind is blowing from his left to right and is swirling.
From 49 for the win.
Oh!
Goal! Albany gets it! Off the crossbar, and the Great Danes go nuts! Shocking Stony Brook in a thriller! Have you ever seen anything like that? A celebration in the snow.
Hey, listen, if you're going to do a commercial for college football, take a shot right there. Look at the jubilation. This game had more twists and turns than a movie script. And in a rivalry game, Albany hoisting the Golden Apple Trophy shocked Stony Brook. Just an incredible finish to a really entertaining football game. Sometimes as broadcasters, you just let the pictures tell the story. Now take a look. He hits it well. Again, the wind affects it just a tad, and it hits the bottom of the goal post and creaks over. In a game where almost nothing has, in a season where almost nothing has gone right for Albany, they get a lucky bounce at the end of the game, and winner, winner, chicken dinner.
Albany had lost three times in the final 30 seconds this season. It looked like it would be number four. But the ball bouncing their way. And now it'll be a very tough 18 hours for Stony Brook as they will have to watch the selection show tomorrow. If you're the Seawolves, you still feel good about your postseason chances, but it's Albany that wins the Golden Apple Trophy. A thriller in New York. Back to wrap things up in a moment. In a game that represented everything that's great about college athletics, Albany beating Stony Brook on the last play in an absolute thriller. What a game, Ken Dunnett.
Well, Matt, I told you earlier that I thought this was the most entertaining season I have ever seen conference-wise in my 30-plus years of covering college football. And the last play of the last game of the year was absolutely unbelievable. A field goal hits the bottom of the goal post and creeps over, and Albany gets their first conference win.
And here are the final CAA standings. Maine is the conference winner. JMU is assured a postseason berth at 8-3. Stony Brook, Towson, Delaware, and Elon will all watch the selection show tomorrow anxiously. We think a minimum of two will get in, probably three, maybe four. No conference has ever gotten six teams into the FCS playoffs, but the CAA certainly has a chance. But today it was an incredible game as Ethan Stark, the hero, Albany's kicker, gets the bounce.
Incredible game-ending, game-winning field goal by a kicker who had missed a couple late. And jubilation in Albany as they get their one and only conference win to end the season.
A great year by our entire Fox College Sports crew. For Eric Singer, Mark Balk, Ken Dunnick, I'm Matt Janis. Thanks so much for tuning in, not only tonight, but all season long. A fitting cap and a great celebration Albany hoists the Golden Apple Trophy as they spoil Stony Brook's season finale. The Great Danes win it 25-23. Thanks so much, everybody, and have a great night.